I'm not usually one to quote London Mayor Boris Johnson, but here's a paraphrase of something he once said about the journey of life. He said life is like driving from North London to Heathrow Airport. At first, the journey seems to take forever. You inch ahead in traffic. You're dying to be on your way. It's frustrating that the days seem to last forever. And then suddenly you reach Earl's Court and the traffic parts and you're hurtling terrifyingly fast towards your final destination. And there's nothing you can do to hold back the time. Here's the writer, Graeme Linehan.
Having to wait an hour to watch a cartoon is torture for a child. Whereas when you're 40, years pass without you realizing, oh, that was 5 years ago? I thought it was last year. You know, all this stuff. Yeah. It's quite shocking how that happens.
Is it because you've done everything, you know, or you've done a lot more and everything becomes like, oh, well, you know, because when you do something for the second or the third time, it's like, because even now when you go on holiday, you know, the first day on holiday seems to last forever, but by the 13th day when you're in the routine of the pool and then lunch, goes like that.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think that's a really good way of putting it. But also I think it's something to do with the amount of time you have left. You know, flies see time really slowly compared to us. They live for, what, a day or something, or 2 days, or a week, or I don't know.
I think it seems to last forever.
Very short time. Well, that's why when you go to swat a fly, the fly's thought process is, oh, there's a hand coming down. I better think about moving out of the way at some point. You know, I'll finish this meal first, and by the time you've hit the table, he's long gone. So I think it's something to do with that as well. Just the closer we get to the grave, the faster time seems.
So what can slow down time? Fear can slow down time. I got lost. I was with my family husky sledding in Norway last Christmas. And we got lost in the wilderness and had to break into a cabin, and the huskies were howling, and we had to smash a window and break into a cabin. And
bloody hell, really?
Yeah, oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Jesus.
I know. The one good thing I will say for that night was it seemed to last forever. Time slowed down. I didn't hurt. I was actually hurtling towards possible death that night, and it seemed to go on and on and on. We were lost for maybe 8 hours, and it felt like days. So when you actually are hurtling towards death, it slows down.
Yeah, well, that might be nice. Yeah, I kind of nearly drowned once on holiday, and I can't really remember what time did. I think an undertow grabbed me, and I did that thing where I stuck my head up over the water thinking I was just a few feet from the beach, and I was a long way from the beach. And I started going in, and the tide kept pulling me out again, and finally I got really tired and just said, I actually did have that moment where I thought, because I was so embarrassed about shouting help, because I was a teenager, and all the guys who were swimming around me were powerfully built guys who would usually beat me up. So the idea of shouting help was, and I just thought, I'd rather die than shout help. So I did go under once, you know, and then I thought, actually, no. so then I was into this weird thing of hearing my voice saying, help, which just, I can't emphasize enough. I think people should practice shouting help at home. I think they should go into a soundproof room and go, help, because when you really do need to shout help, you know, you better have some conviction. And I didn't. I was like, help, help, help me. Help, please. I think I'm drowning. I really think I'm drowning.
This must be underwater love. And they are feet slipping all over me. This must be underwater love.
You know, people say that if they're being attacked, don't shout help because people don't come.
Yeah,
you know, you're supposed to shout
fire.
Because,
yeah.
You know, as Harry Shearer once said to me, he said, there's something that matters more to people than the greatest art and the greatest comedy, the greatest theatre, watching things burn.
Well, it's a great story. That this guy, Slane Castle, do you know Slane Castle in Ireland?
Yeah.
He has all these big concerts there and stuff. Lord something. I met him once and he said Slane Castle was on fire. And he says there were some firemen and they were literally hosing the place, you know. And he was standing nearby, you know, looking at his life going up in flames. One of the firemen turned to the other one and said, isn't this a great fire? Because, you know, if you're going to get called out, it's great to... This is a big one, isn't it? It's great. You know what I mean? I love that story.
Graeme Linehan, I realise that we've diverged from the topic of this programme, which is how to stop time. Ronald Mallett is a physicist at the University of Connecticut. is in the midst of a lifelong struggle to not only stop time, but actually reverse it. And he thinks he may be close. He says it began with his father.
He was the center of my life. And he was a really terrific person. He was a radio and television repairman. And he worked very, very hard, and he lived very hard, too. And we didn't know that he had a weak heart, and he died of a massive heart attack. And he was only 33 at the time, and I was 10 years old. And the shock of it just overwhelmed me. And for about a year, I was just in a haze, a depressive haze. I just was lost without him, totally lost.
Soon after his father died, Ronald was wandering past a second-hand bookshop when a front cover caught his eye. It was a book by H.G. Wells.
It was sitting right there on the rack, and it said The Time Machine, and it had this really interesting cover with this man sitting on this device. And just from the cover alone, it was like, I have to say, it's like Saul on the road to Damascus. I mean, it just struck me. I knew this was the solution. A time machine, and that if I could build this time machine, I could see my father again and tell him what was going to happen, and I could change everything.
And did you try and build one at the age of 11?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I did. My mother had kept the parts of radios and things that my father had, junk parts.
So bits of washing machines and...
Tires, bicycle tires.
And a seat, right?
A bicycle seat, you know.
A dial to show what year you'd be in?
Well, it was a clock inside and a clock that I had outside, because I knew from in the story that the clock inside shouldn't be affected, but the clock, you know, outside the machine should change as I'm moving through time.
But you must have been incredibly nervous that the day you decided to sit down and turn on the machine.
Oh, I was, because I thought this could be it. This could take me back to those happy times. And of course, when I put it all together and tried turning it on, nothing happened.
It's 53 years later. Ronald has become massively respected in the theoretical physics community. He's got doctorates, and he says he's done it all for one secret reason, so he can learn to build a time machine and see his father again.
This probably shouldn't surprise you. I didn't get my job at the University of Connecticut by saying I was going to build a time machine. I got it by saying that I was going to study Einstein's theory of general relativity and the theory of black holes and the theory of the universe. So I kept it as a secret.
So you have quite seriously made some very real headway in the field of time travel.
That's correct. The theory that I developed, the equations I developed, show that by using circulating light, it can create a type of gravitational field that will lead to the possibility of time travel both into the future and into the past.
So you've got to somehow describe that in a way that my brain isn't going to explode.
Well, I think that I can give you a pretty clear picture of how this works. In Einstein's theory, space acts like a medium. It can be expanded, it can be bent, it can be twisted. Now, here's the analogy. Imagine that you have a cup of coffee in front of you. Think of the coffee in the cup as being like empty space. Mm-hmm. Now, let's suppose you have a spoon. Now, the spoon will represent the circulating light beam, and that's important because my work is based on creating a beam of light that moves around in a loop. Now, what happens to your coffee is you take the spoon and stir it around. The coffee starts swirling around, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. That's what the circulating light beam will do to empty space. Mm-hmm. Now, suppose that you put a sugar cube into the coffee. Mm. And now, as you stir the coffee around, what's going to happen to the sugar cube? That's right, it dissolves. Well, let's use something else besides a sugar cube. Let's say a coffee bean, all right?
Okay.
So I put a coffee bean into the cup. Very good.
Thank you. I really thought that was the right answer there.
No one has actually said that before. That's very good. So let's put a coffee bean in there, okay? And so now as I'm stirring the coffee around, what happens to the coffee bean?
It spins around.
Right, exactly. The coffee starts spinning the coffee bean around. Well, now the thing that will play the role of the coffee bean in empty space is, let's take a subatomic particle called a neutron. A neutron is an important part of every atom.
I'm sorry to those people listening who really want to know what Ronald is about to say for the next 10 minutes, but I have to fade him out here. I'm sorry. But if you want the full physics explanation, as well as Ronald's extraordinary story, you can read it all in his book, The Time Traveler.
So what does this mean? This means that I can move from the future back to the past.
And when did you finally admit to your scientific peer group that you had this hidden agenda?
This was a physics conference that happened in 2002. In Washington, D.C., at the International Association of Relativistic Dynamics. This is a group of my peers who are all experts in general relativity. And I gave the usual technical talk, but at the end of the talk, I decided to deviate from usual protocol. And I mentioned to the audience my personal reason for being interested in time travel and for the work that I had been doing. That is to say, the death of my father and the desire to see him. And that is when, you might say, I came out of the time travel closet, in a sense.
The picture in my mind is of, you know, one of those old movies, like Dr. Frankenstein, you know, showing his monster to the audience, and then there's a kerfuffle breaks out, and everybody's refusing to listen. Is that what it's like?
Well, the thing is that I thought that that's what was going to happen. But what surprised me was that one of the most highly respected physicists in the audience, by the name of Price DeWitt, and very famous during the question and answer period, he said, "I don't know whether you'll ever see your father again, but he would have been proud of you." And for him to make that public statement for me and not ridicule, it was just the most wonderful thing that had happened to me. And I felt really complete satisfaction as a result of that.
Ronald Mallett isn't the only person I know who's experimenting with time travel. There's the writer and comedian Josie Long. At 26, Josie's our youngest contributor, and so, in the North London to Heathrow journey of life, she's still stuck in traffic on Euston Road.
Some days last about 4 years. Like, if you're doing the Edinburgh Festival, you'll do 4 gigs in a day, and you'll feel like you've had a week in a day. So, that's a very good sign. That suggests that I'm young and chipper. This year I've been away loads. I've been away like 6.5 months out of 8 touring, and for one stint I was away from my boyfriend. We didn't see each other for 66 days. I know that precisely, that it was 66 days. It was just very, very hard to spend that much time away from someone. And we had charts where you could cross off the days, and sometimes you would just look at that amount of days and it would seem totally like it would never, ever be over. After about 10 days, I was in Adelaide, and I remember really saying to myself, I'm going to close my eyes really, really tightly, and the next time I open them, I'm going to be in Japan, which is where I met my boyfriend in Tokyo, which is very romantic. I remember I was like, I'll close my eyes, and the next time I open my eyes, I'm going to be in Tokyo. And then I realised that you close your eyes, and then the next time you'll be aware of doing that will be 3 or 4 days later. So it's like you've got the cheapest, lamest time travel equipment at your disposal all the time.
Well, I don't quite understand it, I've got to say. What,
oh, no,
were you on a plane?
Saying...
Were you in a room? No, I think I might have missed a crucial line.
Oh, no. Well, it was just... Oh, no, now I do sound mentally ill. It was just this technique that, like...
So you close your eyes. I mean, I can understand if you're on a plane going from Adelaide to Tokyo.
I'm
going to
close my eyes, and before I realise it, I'm going to be there. And then you have to get back on with the day and get on with the boring bits. But then the next time... Oh, no, it does just sound mentally ill. But then when you get there... You remember the fact that all those weeks ago you were saying, God, before I know it, I should be there. And then you're there and you appreciate it, and it's almost as if that time hasn't happened.
But does it work? It does work, right? These markers.
Yes, it does work. And it's nice to always think, this will be shorter than I know, and regardless of what I do, time will just mean marching on, and that is reassuring and great. Because if I wanted, I could sit still in this chair for 64 days and I would still see him because the time would still have gone. It made me feel like I had some sort of really paltry control over time. So yeah, if I could speed up time, that would be ideal.
Josie Long. In Penzance, a man called Tony Wright, who's much older than Josie, is painfully aware that time is running out. And he's realised how much precious time we waste every day being asleep. Tony has taught himself to stay awake for days on end.
Some of the conclusions I've reached suggest to me that some of the time we spend sleeping is perhaps unnecessary and we could be engaged in more creative aspects of life.
Because I remember when, you know, I was young and Margaret Thatcher let it be known that she only had 4 hours sleep a night, and loads of people I knew all sort of thought, well, if, you know, if Margaret Thatcher can only sleep 4 hours a night, we're going to train ourselves to only sleep 4 hours a night. And I was one of those people, but I lasted like 2 nights because I actually quite enjoy sleeping. Does your perception of time change when you've stayed awake? Does every minute feel like an hour, or indeed every hour feel like a minute?
Yes, that is something that does seem to happen consistently. It's just this constant, very engaging, in-the-moment experience. It's almost like a childlike experience of just being completely engaged.
Is it dangerous for the untrained to stay awake?
Yeah, I mean, it's something I've been investigating and practicing for a long time. I'd never suggest anybody stay awake for any longer than they would normally do unless they're fairly psychologically stable and prepared for a bit of a challenge. It's not something to be taken too lightly. I mean, it does change the way your mind works. I hooked up with Manchester University and managed to persuade them to run some tests while I stayed awake for, I think it was about 5 days, and they were very sceptical and presumed that I was simply mad or deluded and would be easy to disprove what I was suggesting.
Uh-huh.
And they ran tests every 3 hours or so, and they were somewhat perplexed because the sort of expectation would be a severe decline in ability, and not only did I hold my own, but actually things improved over the 5 days quite significantly.
What's the longest you stayed awake for?
The longest, well, it was just over 11 days.
Did you break the world record?
I broke a record.
Which record was it? The Penzance record?
The Penzance record for staying awake, yes. Well, I think it probably is the Penzance record for staying awake.
And after 11 days, did you feel, like, even better than you did after 7 days?
Well, I kind of got a bit stir-crazy, and I was really desperate to get out, and there was a lot of people that had been in asking me questions, and I just really wanted a break, so...
I hate people asking me questions when I haven't slept.
Yeah.
Tony says he can prove that sleeplessness can make you a better, more intelligent, more coordinated person. He says he'll stay awake for a few days and then I can experiment on him. This I will do later in the programme. But first, the comedian Danny Robbins visits Fiona Houston in Scotland, who spent a year living in 1793.
Fiona, I'm Danny.
Welcome to 18th century Scotland.
Thank you very much. Wow. So this is the 1793 cottage?
Yeah.
Is this where I'll be sleeping tonight?
Yes. On a straw mattress.
That's not sprung, then?
No, I'm, as it were, on the floor, but give it a poke. That's straw.
So that's straw?
Yes.
Am I going to have things confiscated?
Well, I don't want you to use your mobile phone and your electrocommunications equipment. I think that would really be cheating.
Do you want me to hand things over now?
Why not?
My mobile.
Not the laptop.
Sunglasses?
Well, I've seen engravings of people with coloured glasses in them. I can show you one. So perhaps we'll lay your sunglasses.
I can get those. I do feel slightly panicky about the idea of handing over my mobile phone to you.
I'm sure, yes. You're going to be out of contact.
Are you travelling back in time because you are frightened of what might happen in the future? Do you want to try and keep time in one place because you don't like where it's going?
I don't like where it's going. Yeah, it's an interesting question that I think there is a big bit of me that harks back to the past as a better time. I like more simple living because it demands more of you as an individual. It demands that you use your ingenuity to solve problems.
Wanderers this morning came by. Where do they faithful in the morning light to banner there to follow you.
Come through to the garden.
So are we going to get some stuff for tea tonight?
Yeah, let's see what there is. Can you dig down again?
Yeah. So, do you think the only way to stop time is to cut yourself off from other people?
Yes, I think that probably does do it for you.
If you're by yourself, you've got as much time as you want.
Yes. Would you like to heave green one out?
Oh, more potatoes, okay. Yeah. I feel calmer already, you know.
You do?
Yeah. I've had quite a hectic couple of weeks before I came here, and it's nice. I've just been sitting chopping the vegetables, and I could feel myself relaxing.
Good. Well, let's see whether you can do some more relaxing. You any good at chopping wood?
I'll give it a go.
Okay.
Oh, there we go.
It's a good feeling.
Whoa. Beautiful. Oh, that was a bad one. Okay. I wasn't satisfied with it. I'm going to go for another one. I've got quite an impractical fringe here, so I'm having to use my sunglasses to keep my hair out of my eyes whilst I chop wood.
I thought you were talking about your personality, not your hair.
Oh, I missed.
You missed.
Yes.
Beautiful.
Yes.
Through the forest, down to your grave, where the birds wait and the tall grasses wait.
The city pollutes me.
Hooray, you're out in the country. Yes. Good. This is what I want to hear.
You know, one of the things that I would find hardest about living in the 18th century is not being able to moisturise.
What do you put on your face apart from that?
Well, I have a three-step skincare regime. I use moisturiser, scrubbing lotion, and face soap.
One product is designed to make you need another product. Did you know that, Danny? Did you know that you're a victim of consumerism?
But these are all... These are ways to prolong my life, though. These
nonsense. How often do you shampoo your hair?
Most days.
Again, you see, it's that product generating the need for product. Try doing it once a week.
I'd be worried about smelling, though.
Male odours are sexy. You know what the Marquis de Sade did to attract women? He used to put a pad under his armpits and then waft it under their noses.
That's the least of what he does, isn't it? It's dinner time. This looks lovely, Fiona. When you'd lived for a whole year in 1793, did it become 1794?
I got out at that point.
I'm in bed. The straw mattress isn't very comfortable. And, I have a confession to make. I've cheated slightly, and I've smuggled in a midnight feast. I've got some crisps here.
Before I came here to see Fiona, I was really worried that I was losing a day and not achieving lots of things I should be doing. But I actually feel like I've gained a day. I have stopped time. I've slowed myself down. I feel calmer. I feel more relaxed. I feel better equipped to go back to the real world. It's time to go to sleep now.
Uncomfortable and I need the toilet. Is my time in the 18th century over? I can come back to the 21st century. Okay. Thank you.
Danny Robbins.
So we're in a hotel in London, Tony, and you've been awake for how long?
I last slept, I think I woke up, or set my alarm for 6 a.m. Saturday morning, so what, 50 plus hours now, I guess, something like that.
And you look terrible.
Thank you. I always look terrible, so there's no change there.
And you're teaching David Blaine to stay awake. Because I thought that it was always with David Blaine, it was a trick, and like maybe he'd just paint eyeballs onto his closed eyelids. But you're actually teaching him to stay awake for how long?
He's claiming that he's going to stay awake for about 11 and a half days, or he's calculated that that's very close to 1 million seconds, so he's going to go with 1 million seconds, which is a nice little hookah, I have to admit.
All right, so you've been awake for like 50 hours. Are there any tests we can do? You alluded when we spoke last time to there being tests to prove that
being awake longer makes you better. What about this kind of maths tests or verbal tests that we can do now and then maybe when we see one?
I don't have a bog standard list of tests, but if you've got any ideas.
Okay, I'm going to try some things. I want you to answer straight away, okay? 9 plus 3.
11. Yeah, go on.
All right, so that's not great.
No, sorry.
Okay, let's try a different one because the answer's 12.
Yeah, it is.
18 plus 2.
20.
9 fours.
36.
Correct. But if we'd done this on Friday, would you have been even worse?
Yeah, possibly. I mean, probably, as I say, 5 days would be more interesting. I wouldn't regard this as a particularly extended run.
I'm going to try a few more tests. Okay. Name 3 films that everybody thought were good, but actually were rubbish.
3 films that everybody thought was good, but rubbish. God, I'm not much of a film buff. I really can't think of any at the moment that people thought were good.
Yeah. Lost in Translation.
Never seen it.
Okay. All right, what other questions can I do? Okay. A man pushes his car around a corner. He stops it outside a hotel. He gives the hotel owner £1,000 and then he pushes it away again. Why?
No, it's... I don't know.
He's playing Monopoly. What are the tests? If there was a loud noise, would you jump out of your skin?
I usually don't. I don't normally jump unexpectedly, but I wouldn't say never, but, you know... I see these are quite deeply thought-out experiments.
I jumped, and I'm the one who bangs the cup on the table.
I don't normally jump an awful lot in response to that kind of stuff, but, you know, maybe once in a while I would.
I can vouch that you didn't jump at all.
Mm.
Not even like when you've had sleep, you wouldn't jump.
I'm aware, but I don't kind of, there's not an immediate sort of panic response anywhere. I'm normally fairly calm when things like that go off. I can juggle a bit better, not that I'm much of a juggler. I can only manage about 3 balls, but I can juggle better when I've been awake.
I've got biscuits here, will you juggle with them?
Does nobody want to eat them?
No.
I wouldn't want to eat them after I've juggled with them, but I don't know how easy biscuits are to juggle. No. They're a bit awkward.
Well, it's not bad. And at one point I might do a loud noise while you're juggling.
I need some round things, they're a bit awkward.
I can vouch that Tony didn't drop the biscuits. And it's also true that whilst he looks haggard and exhausted, he will, for good or ill, be experiencing life for many, many hours longer than the rest of us.